out, everybody. I'm excited for this conversation. And real quick, you know, because we wanted to talk about people who are involved in the conversation online, who aren't involved in the conversation online. By show of hands, how many people here are like signed into a social network once a day, at least? Is there anybody here who is not in a network at all, doesn't do that? Okay, I'm excited to...
I'm proud of it.
Yeah, to get you to ask some questions at the end of this. So I want to talk a little bit, starting with what David and Kimberly do online. What do you do online all day?
What do we do?
And we're going to start with David because he actually works with an older technology, which is SMS messaging, and I am such a millennial that I was like, wow, I don't even know what that is. Like the easier
It's coming
technology.
Back with all those weird keyboards now you have on the... On the SMS, like Bitmoji, I don't know if you've heard of Bitmoji, and you can create your avatar and all kinds of stuff. But anyway, SMS, it happens to be the holy grail, I think, about when it comes to reaching out to people, because if you've ever noticed, when you download an app, the app will ask you to opt into their push notification, right? It's if the app doesn't get that from you, it's lost in the background. It might never reach out back to you. It might be forgotten forever. So push notification is the only way for the app to reach back to you. SMS is push notification by default. There's no way to turn it off unless you just completely cancel the program. So text messaging happens to be the best way if you want to build a platform that reaches out to people and really is out there and creates a pulse in the community. Text messaging is still very, very critical.
Yeah, the way you were kind of explaining it to me is like, where does the program live? Does the program live on the server or live on your phone?
Exactly, and the only difference between a text message and a message within an app is really where the application is living. If it's a text message, there is still an application living somewhere in the server side, on the computer, in the cloud or something like that, but you're getting delivered just basic content.
So, for example, how I did make sense of this is that I do use SMS with my Twitter account. I get a text message from 40404 when somebody messages me, and when I don't have data on my smartphone, I can send a message to that number 40404 and it will get published on my Twitter account. So what we're looking at here, David, is kind of like a visual representation of Pase la Voz.
Yes, Pase la Voz, which is the name in Spanish, which means spread the word, is the sister service to Relayed, which is the English version of the same service. We just branded it differently because we have two audiences, one Spanish, one English. And what you're looking at here is just four simple slides of why this service works in the community. It's an easy voice activation, so this means that when people subscribe, they actually call a phone number, which is something that we've done for the past maybe 100 years.
So this isn't voice activation like Siri, this is like I'm dialing a
phone number. Okay. If I could do it with Siri, that would be awesome. Mm-hmm. So it's easy to sign up, that gets most people involved. I think we might have more cell phones than people in the United States already. So. As long as you have a phone number and a phone, you can sign up. Even from a landline, actually, if you just call again, you can actually enter your zip code through the dial tone. The members create their own content, and so they report the content to the call center, takes the report or they text it in, and then it's sent back to the other subscribers locally. So everything is word of mouth. The way the system spreads and the service spreads, everything is word of mouth. I would tell you to call that number because you're my friend. And just connections build community, and that's what we're going to talk about too.
Yeah, so is Pase la Voz, are people just reporting checkpoints or traffic stops, or has it expanded to more content?
99% of the content on Pase la Voz and Relayed are police checkpoints on the road in five different states in the South: Virginia, South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, Tennessee, I might have mentioned more than five, but mostly in the South, where police seem to be misbehaving a little more than the rest of the country. There's a lot of racial profiling, so we alert people about police checkpoints so that people know where they are.
But now people are using it for other content as well.
So there's other content that we're funneling through: job alerts, missing people sometimes are reported. There's other small cases that it's useful for, but mostly the most interesting content to the majority of this crowd, which is about 1 million subscribers, is where the police are doing either immigration checkpoints or just checking for licenses, tax, insurance, all kinds of stuff.
So who is your average user in Virginia? Is it somebody who might have a Twitter account and also be subscribed to this service? What would this service be giving them that they're not going to find on a Twitter account or a Facebook account?
So the way that Twitter works, it wouldn't be possible to maintain this sort of service. First of all, the content, unless you opt into the SMS, wouldn't reach out to you. And so it would have less of a pulse in the community. And when you have less of a pulse, you have less of a reaction from that community reporting back to you. So the whole feedback loop works better with SMS. Twitter, you would have to tweet to a lot of people, and there is a way for them to report, but it's still public when they do, so you would retweet it. And there's no way of getting a voice conversation over. And that is a very key thing for people that, even if they have Twitter, a voice conversation is very important to get a real sense of where the person is, getting better information from the user when they're on the ground. If they're close to the police, they're gonna want to be very discreet. They might not be able to text, and so they will call you. And even in the emotion that the person expresses on the phone, you will get a sense of whether that person is even being truthful or not. It's very important to have a more human contact when it comes to this sort of content.
Mm-hmm. And is this your only slide?
That's my only slide. Okay. I put all my slides in one.
All the info is right up there. So let's switch to talking about a platform that we were already kind of working into the conversation because it's so predominant, and that is Twitter. And to you, Dr. Goddess, can you tell people a little bit about what you do all day on the Twitter?
All right. Well, I tweet a lot. I wanted to start off just talking about how I can remember about 10 to 15 years ago, the discussion around the African community, the African American community, the Black community in general was about the digital divide. The question and so much of our conversation was about affordability of desktop computers, even laptop computers, and especially, I live in an African American working class community in Pittsburgh called the Historic Hill District, and I can remember the computer classes that we had at our community center, and I can remember the discussions that we had, even so much as, you know, community members criticizing other community members saying, you know, don't buy your child, you know, that pair of sneakers, buy them a computer, right? And so when I think about the way that the technology has changed, most people know now that mobile has surpassed the use of the desktop computer. And what has been amazing that we've seen is that when it comes to mobile technology, there is no digital divide. And that is a beautiful thing. And it is directly related to why and how this community that I tend to discuss called Black Twitter, how it came to be. First of all, as David discussed, the SMS platform is very popular, and the SMS platform was and still is the standard for Twitter. So that's part of the reason why it's so easy to see Twitter on your phone. When it comes to the transference of technology, you know, even while we had a quote-unquote digital divide in our community, you still had people who had pagers. So they may not have been able to afford, you know, a desktop computer or a laptop, but they had pagers. And really, I mean, the pager was like the first really, really popular mobile unit. And so when people ask me why is Twitter the thing? Why did that become so popular in the Black community? And I believe it's just the transference of technology from the use of pager and the SMS technology to Twitter and getting Twitter on your phone.
And just to be clear, it seems like we have a lot of experienced people here, but Black Twitter is not a separate thing from Twitter.
Right, exactly. Right,
no,
so yeah, let me explain.
Secret special URL
let me explain.
Or anything.
Yeah. So case in point, what you're looking at, this brown Twitter bird, I'm gonna get to that in a second. I just want you to appreciate it and enjoy it. All right. And, you know, I like to talk about how, you know, technology is not new for black people. Everything from the sundial to remixing turntables and the creation of hip-hop, we're not afraid of technology. We're not new to technology. We've engaged in creativity and technology for quite some time. Literally, it's a part of our ancient history. So, in 2010, Slate Magazine produced an article called What Black People Do on Twitter. And the majority of the article stressed how funny Black Twitter was and how we had these great hashtags that pop up around midnight. And the hashtags that they chose to focus on were, you know, hey, did you see the hashtag, you know your ghetto if? Hey, did you see the hashtag, if Santa was black, you know, blah, blah, blah. Now, it's true, Black Twitter is very funny, but for those of us who have been on the site, and I've been on since January of 2009 is when I signed on, and I think that I really got my Twitter legs that summer. So like many users, I was sort of kind of stuck and feeling my way through for a few months. I didn't just jump on and just kind of know what to do. But the one thing I did do right was to start following a lot of different people. And that's probably because I'm real nosy. So I started following, you know, PR reps and journalists and, you know, celebrities and my television shows and the news. And so I had an excellently curated timeline pretty early on. In August of 2009, the G20 came to Pittsburgh. That's where I'm from. And to make a long story short, there was a bit of rioting during the G20, and it was also the time period in which the police decided to do a training for police all across the nation. So we had multitudes of police officers in the city, which I thought was perfectly fine because, you know, people do get assassinated. And I was like, you know, Barack Obama's the first black president. We got to protect him, bring all the police in. I had no idea what I was cheering for, obviously. But so there was a bit of rioting like around the college campuses later on that night. And I went out and I just started taking pictures on my BlackBerry and just using the hashtag G20 because that was the hashtag. And I started to see that like people were following me, and even less so following me, they were retweeting me, and those tweets were going viral. And then when I clicked on a hashtag, I could see, I saw that my friend, Jasiri X, who's a popular hip hop artist now, who wasn't at the time, that he was like two blocks away from me. I looked and I saw Mr. Davey D was also three blocks away. And what I saw from our own communications, even Paradise Gray from X-Clan, I thought, wow, like the four of us are out here. We're like, we have like different posts. Our tweets are trending. And we were beating the mainstream media. And that shocked me because I saw the cameras out there. I saw KDK, I saw the stations, and yet it was our tweets that superseded their reports. And that is truly, I mean, I've been an activist and an organizer my whole life, and that is when it clicked for me that Twitter could be an excellent mechanism for black people in particular who are often maligned by, misrepresented by, denigrated, you know, in mainstream media, that we might be able to tell our tale in our own way and to also use Twitter for social activism. That was 2009.
Yeah.
So by the time...
Well, I wanted to point out that, you know, that you basically become the primary source, and this is still how Twitter works today, that
yes.
I can even just this summer watching that really awful weekend in Baltimore, when the police incited a riot with young people who were trapped at a bus station. I'm watching the CNN live feed and looking up all the neighborhood, the street names on Twitter. And, you know, with my colleagues at work, we're like, oh, the kids are about to go left. And then you see them start heading left. That it was like, by watching Twitter, by triangulating all the media forms that you're using still today in 2015, you can have an advantage on the mainstream media, on the police,
absolutely,
on the people on the ground, just from your phone or from your desktop.
Absolutely. And just the point with regard to Slate in the article is that in 2010, when Slate, you know, that really was one of the first, if not the first, mainstream representations of Black Twitter. And I mean, mind you, they didn't say Black Twitter, they just said what Black people do on Twitter. And so I wrote a response saying why they don't understand what black people do on Twitter, because I felt that it was reductive and a bit disrespectful to only talk about the way in which we generate laughs. And then there was a, you know, Marlon Wayans was a very popular person in 2009 and 2010 on Twitter. And he was one of the first celebrities that I saw who had like hundreds of thousands of followers. And really, Marlon Wayans could almost single-handedly make a hashtag trend. Because, you know, he's a beloved comedian in our community, and so he might start something off and then it would trend. But all that to say, Any Vinny, who is a blogger, she, and the graphic artist, she decided to complicate the narrative by producing these brown Twitter birds. So the first brown Twitter bird with a just a ball cap is what Slate produced. And she was screaming and saying, you know, we are not a monolith. You know, you need to understand that we are a multifaceted, complex community. We are all different people. And so she created these different brown Twitter birds. And as you can see, I mean, there's an African head wrap, you know, brother with his rims, you know, graduates, the afro, the do-rag. And I mean, you know, do-rag history week is phenomenal in black Twitter in particular. And so, I mean, that was really important. And again, so this was the first time that black people on Twitter, we fell in love with these brown Twitter birds. So we all were asking all the graphic artists that we knew, could you make me one? I want one, I want one, I want one. And so I got mine. And I do love her so much. And you know, I'm Dr. Goddess because of Dr. Goddess is my stage name. I got on Twitter to do my art. And then I found that more people were asking me questions about American history and feminism and the whole nine, and so I was answering questions. So that's the books, and then as you see, I have my BlackBerry, and then I have a dance background, so those are my dance shoes, okay. But I mean, it is representative of that we are complex and multifaceted people. We're not a monolith. And the term Black Twitter, I use it because it's become very popular, but the fact of the matter is there's no one community. No, you cannot find Black Twitter by using the hashtag Black Twitter. We are, as I see it, a multitude of concentric circles of communities that make up the overall narrative called Black Twitter.
So why do you think, and you know, if someone just like wandered into this room, they've never heard of Twitter before, it's like, oh, I would feel like, okay, Latinos like use SMS technology, black people and white people are on Twitter, where is everybody else? Like, what do you think it is about the black community and maybe the way that mainstream media and white people frame the black community that has given rise just to a black Twitter as opposed to like Mexican Twitter or Indian Twitter or Korean Twitter? That there might not be that same community.
There are communities of Latino tweeting communities. I forget the names, but there are efforts to bring them together under a common cause or a theme.
Tactical Twitter. Phrase I hear a lot.
In Pasa La Voz and Relay, we have other communities. It's not just actually Hispanics are now maybe 30%. But there's a large African-American community that is following Relay or participating in Pase La Voz. A big turning point, we only were focused on the Hispanic. A big turning point was when we saw that Lumbee Indians, which is a Native American tribe in the south part of North Carolina, started to subscribe and were asking to understand what the Spanish content was all about. They knew what it was for and they could tell what some of the street names are. Because when we send them an alert, obviously the street names are there and they're always in English, except for the other words around it that explain, well, this is a police checkpoint on this street. And they were asking, you know, what do these other words mean? And then we decided we would do it in English. And when we did that, more people started subscribing. We now have a group of libertarians that are signed on who are not very comfortable with anything related to the state. And they love the service. So now you have libertarians helping people that maybe they would have never communicated with. You have Hispanics reporting things, and then we turn it into a language and we send it out to an African American. Mm-hmm. And so they are, through this service, they are connecting to each other without maybe ever otherwise have the desire to help each other.
And I feel like that's what Twitter does, it's just so public. But I, you know, we actually long for a private network ourselves, actually.
Yeah, that's what's inspiring about hearing about, you know, this old technology that is still old technology that is still being used. You know, my first experience in an online community was message boards, and feeling like that is kind of like maybe where we're headed back to is a message board, a login, something that is much more selective, possibly.
So it's an old technology, but it's not really being used in an old way. So when we send an alert out, for example, it has a link to a website that we have where people can actually confirm or deny a particular incident on the ground. So it's very interactive. We use voice, SMS to deliver the message, but also the web to support and enrich that content. So you could really create a whole app-like feeling through SMS, voice, and the web together without people ever having to download an application, which is one of the hardest things for many people out there still.
So I want to ask the two questions that are the driving questions of this program. And the first one is, can technological tools and culture be combined for the greater good? Yes or no?
Absolutely. I mean, I can show you this slide. I show this to people because I want them to know that Black Twitter organized itself around different themes. And as I said, there are many different communities. And on the left side is a list of formal organized chats, like Blacklit Chat occurs every Sunday at 9 p.m. on Twitter. Hip Hop Ed, using hip hop, the music, the language, the values, the standards to transform education occurs every Monday at 9. Small Biz Chat, Melinda, I think she has like 500,000, something like that. Her Small Biz Chat is so big, and I have to say, I want to say partly because initially people did not know that she was Black, and so she was hosting Small Biz Chat, and she's with like the Small Business Administration registered. She has so many people participating in her chats that she can charge advertising fees. I'm like, I want to be you when I grow up. But so there's a, you know, I started Grad Chat just to teach people about grad school and say, you know, you don't always have to pay. These are different ways that you can get by. And then that led to other people creating PhD Chat, Black EDU. There's the Black Weblog Awards. Blogging While Brown is an actual conference. The Black Weblog Awards is actually a thing. Blogalicious is a conference, and BBlogalicious is their conference in their site. Too Much Doubt, and Molly and I were talking about this backstage, Too Much Doubt was the hashtag that the NAACP created to help save Troy Davis from being executed by the state. And, you know, it's another reason why, for me, like Black Twitter's activism, I understand that mainstream media kind of caught on with, you know, Paula Deen's Best Dishes, but the truth is that we've been doing this. And I wanted to honor the work that we were doing in our communities, that's why and how I started to put together the book, because it was very clear that if we did not tell our own story, it was gonna be misrepresented and undoubtedly reduced by mainstream media. So there's a ton. I mean, most of you all know the informal hashtags are just popular hashtags that occurred. I guess Nerdland should be over on the formal organized chats because that's Melissa Harris Perry's show. Every Saturday and Sunday, but at the time, it was just sort of open. But in any event, so Too Much Doubt and even the Georgia prison strike are related. If you wanted cultural criticism, internal cultural criticism, and to see what Black people actually think about other Black people and Black culture and our complaints, watching the Soul Train Awards or the BET Awards, you will learn a lot. because I think that Du Bois says the problem of the 21st century is the problem of the color line. He talks about double consciousness. And I do think that what Black Twitter has done, especially for all of America, it has forced Americans to redefine what they think about Black people. And it's been much harder to stereotype us and to, I believe it's the same for many different communities, many different marginalized communities. I mean, it's just been a lot harder to say this is who Black people are, and then Black Twitter roars up and says, no, this is who I am.
Well, and I see that, you know, play out in real time in newsrooms. I've seen that happen, that, you know, editors are more comfortable watching black reaction on Twitter rather than having like an actual real live black person in their newsroom.
Mm-hmm. But that's okay. I feel like watching black reaction on Twitter is a very good thing.
No, I think you should, but you should pair that with actually like hiring black people.
Oh, no doubt. Oh, no doubt. Oh, yeah. Guys, absolutely, absolutely.
So,
absolutely.
You know, and that's something that I think of every time there's a conversation about social networks in or Twitter or Facebook or any sort of way that people talk to each other online. I work in news media, go to news conferences, and there's always this tone, this angle that is slightly dismissive of more or like, how do we get control of this? How do we take advantage of this? How do we make this work for us? That just seems so dismissive and condescending and really, you know, impeding the industry, impeding itself on its own. And so I was kind of wondering that it might be kind of a simple answer, but why do you see so much dismissal of either the network that you run, David, that even on Twitter, why do you see so much dismissal from either mainstream media or from the powers that be around social media?
I think partly is that there's a feeling of threatened, being threatened by something that is more nebulous, more not controlled, more of the people, and it's more unpredictable to have activity out there that doesn't have a strict hierarchy, or you can't talk to somebody at the head and say, you know, I want you guys to do this. So there's that. But we run a network that is actually very controlled, but that is to benefit the subscribers themselves, because if we would leave it completely open to anybody reporting anything and having their reports be sent to other folks on the ground as is, it would be chaos. So some control is necessary, and that's very important to us for what we do. On Twitter, you would be the expert here, so I'll leave that to you.
Well, it's an issue because I'm happy about, well, Twitter has so many problems that also. Talk about condescending, I mean, you know, Molly and I were just talking also about Leslie Mays and his article. He was the last black software engineer at Twitter, and he just quit.
Yeah, he published an essay on Medium this past week. He refused a severance package from Twitter, so he could basically make this public tour saying that with his exit, there is not a single person of color in management in the engineering or product management departments at Twitter. And he juxtaposes this about internet usage, that though it's a smaller slice of internet users in general, 27% of black adults use Twitter versus 21% of white adults. And you know that is the future of the user base, and he really, I recommend that you read it. And it ends up being, it's an essay more about the word diversity and how that is interpreted at the echelons of who controls this free platform that people use.
Absolutely, and I skipped over an important fact, which is how Black Twitter came to be. It's because the Pew Research produced a study showing, it was in 2010, showing that that Black people, while we represent 13 to 14% of the American population, that we are 24 to 27% of Twitter. And so that, the way that we are hyper-represented on Twitter is what literally made us sort of feel like, wow, are we in our own little world here? We're talking to each other, there's a lot of people here. We feel like we're conferencing every day, we're solving all the world's problems. You know, if everybody would just listen to us on Twitter, that would be it. But I find Twitter has been two things that I feel are really problematic. First of all, you know, when Jack and company first released Twitter, it was all about, you know, all the people and, you know, free speech, and it seemed to align itself more so with social activism, digital humanities, right? Which it did. I mean, we're not, you know, the revolution didn't actually occur in America first. Remember Arab Spring and the hashtag Jan 26. January 26th, it was National Police Day in Egypt. And so they decided to subvert the powers that be, and as you know, we had Arab Spring. And I was sort of ashamed actually during Arab Spring, because I was like, America, come on, like we're so late, like get it together. But that was, you know, Jack Dorsey, you know, he was there, he had his team there. I know that they brought Dick Costlow on, and Dick has recently left. But when Dick came on, there seemed to be, I don't know if it was Dick's vision, but it was more so about the business of Twitter. It was more so about advertising. And so the black community, as well as other marginalized communities that are not traditionally represented in mainstream media, became a different type of commodity in that we were a good source of advertising dollars. We were like this untapped potential. And I believe I read that like only 3 to 4% of advertising dollars goes to advertising towards the black community. And I'm sure that it's close to, if not even lower, in the Latino community. And that's a shame, first of all. And second of all, it also means that it makes Twitter ripe for producing more content and producing more advertising dollars. The third thing I learned, which is a problem, is that Twitter was only paying attention when it comes to safety and really anything that had to do with changing how Twitter works. Twitter only listened to celebrities. So, you know, there were Latinos saying, hey, you know, I'm getting trolled. I'm tired of like this constant anti-immigration, you know, in my feed. Black people were saying, I'm getting trolled, you know, I'm tired of the N-words, the assault on Trayvon, et cetera, et cetera. And Twitter really did not pay much attention until, what is it, Jennifer Lawrence, until she quit.
I think she was
like the one of the catalysts. And as more, and Robin Williams' daughter.
Oh, Zelda, yeah, getting, yeah,
when
it's quits. When somebody prominent is harassed, all of a sudden they'll make changes.
Yeah, and then they developed, you know, we've got the safety committee, we've got, and it's like, we were telling you that actually for a really long, I used to tweet to Jack.
Yeah,
and Dick.
And he's now back on as the acting CEO, and that was,
yes,
Leslie Miley's kind of parting silver lining to leaving, that Jack Dorsey, a St. Louis native, is back, someone who really was physically on the ground, during the height of the unrest in Ferguson. And, you know, David, you were talking to me about the difficulty of getting into the world of moderation,
right,
though, that it's a fine line to walk when you are the proprietor of the network.
Right, yeah, and it's many times throughout the growth of Relayed, I have a team, but the question of, you know, what do I do when somebody is doesn't like the content, or somebody does want to sell something on the network or give a service on the network that they don't properly deliver? What do I do? And the answer for us was, let's just become as fluid as possible and as supportive as possible for people to communicate without having to moderate. Not only is it easier, of course, but also it's more true, because when you create a community where you are policing the community, you're really something else. You're providing that service as well, that protection that you were talking about. But what I did was actually take a step back. And for example, when somebody reports a checkpoint, we communicate the confidence level in their report to the community. So instead of, because we used to have a 5-minute rule where we said, okay, if somebody reports a checkpoint here and we're not sure that it is a checkpoint because we're not there, then we'll just wait 5 or 10 minutes and see if somebody else reports a checkpoint there. It doesn't work because the information is only valid for 5 minutes, 5 or 10 minutes. So you lose that time. And if it was a checkpoint and you send it later, then it's not worth anything to anybody. So by actually communicating what the level of certainty that a user on the ground expresses, you become the conduit, which was the original idea at the beginning. Just provide the support for that freedom of speech to occur, connect those nodes, protect the medium, but don't try to necessarily do anything to police it. That's been my philosophy throughout the process and the growth.
So I wanted to also ask the other central question to this program, which is a huge question, and it's, to what extent can we control the technology we create and influence? And I think this year particularly around the most popular. Well, 300 million people are on Twitter. It's about a billion people on Facebook, yet Facebook has a totally different algorithm for how you can see content, where Twitter is just open hose of content if you want it to be. That it seems like this year I've seen a lot more people being like, okay, we need something else. This is not quite working for a number of reasons that you've laid out. So I was like, to what extent, on a scale of 1 to 10, to what extent can we control these technologies? 10 being the most control that we can possibly have over them. Or is there something you get everybody in the town square? It really is like a meeting, a march, and if there's no leaders, you don't know where it's going to go.
Yeah, well, I mean, I wanted to show this slide on about participatory democracy because that is the philosophy that Ella Baker had to, it was her ideal that we should all be able to participate in the democratic system and not be top down. And it's because of this ideology of participatory democracy and allowing anyone to become an activist that someone who was a sharecropper by the name of Fannie Lou Hamer, who just sang a gospel song at church and was asked to register to vote and lost her job as a sharecropper and became homeless, ended up testifying before the National Democratic Convention in 1964. And it's because of, you know, the ideology, which is what and how I see Twitter in a way, because it's still free and open unless you get censored, you know, or blocked or something like that. But particularly if you get censored by Twitter itself. And what I've seen, and just in terms of the way that Black Twitter in particular has literally, especially with the rise of Black Lives Matter, the rise of Ferguson, the names of many people who have been slain, as many of which you all know, and they become hashtags. We're nervous about the control of the technology because A, we don't own Twitter. You know now that barely any Black people work there. I do think that things might be changing because Jack, not only is he from St. Louis, Jack went to Ferguson and was like taking pictures with Ferguson activists and things like that. And I think that that's extremely important that he was on the ground and like saw real live human beings. It's because you won't necessarily, Black human beings that you won't necessarily see in Silicon Valley. And I think the latest thing that we've seen is that DeRay McKesson, who's a very popular tweeter, who gained his popularity from his activism in Ferguson, suggested that he and his team do like a Democratic town hall with the Democratic presidential candidates. And rumor has it, you know, Twitter may co-sponsor or sponsor or something like that, which would be fabulous. And I feel like it would bring Twitter back to its roots. But at the end of the day, that's because of this alliance and this relationship between Black Twitter and Jack the Creator. We still don't create it, we still don't own it, so I have to tip my kufi and hat to David
your
for
Aretha
creating
Franklin
exactly
inauguration
and my Aretha
hat,
inauguration
so
hat to David and Antoine Dodson's, you know, handkerchief up in the upper left hand corner. But yeah, and that, so yeah, and I'm glad you love it because we love these two, and that's why Black Twitter like went crazy over these brown Twitter birds, and we all were like snatching one. But I do think it's really, ultimately, I really think it's very, very important to control your distribution and control your information. You know, quite frankly, when you're a marginalized community, you are often at war with a number of different entities. And obviously, we have a contested relationship, you know, with some wayward police officers, because there are plenty of good police officers out there, but there's far too many who believe that they're above the law, right? And it's problematic that we don't have like this private network, and so, like I said, I tip my hat to the one that you all created.
Thank you.
Yeah. What do you think of that question, David? The extent to which we can control the technologies?
I think it really depends on the content that you're distributing, the goal that you have in mind. Our goal was simply put to give underserved communities more digital real estate. And that's all. That's all I needed to do. I just needed to bring them over to the digital world. And the reason for that was because policy is being more and more dependent on data, and data is being more and more created digitally. They're digitally born. So bringing them to the conversation was a way to give them more stake in policy. It wasn't to create social change. I wasn't as, you know, the goal wasn't as lofty. It was just simply whatever that would be. So I didn't even know where this was going. And as I mentioned, I started just by teaching computer classes to Hispanic adults. And that's where I saw that there was a need for information. And then I didn't wake up one day and say, you know, let's send out police checkpoints. But when I found that that was the content that they wanted, it was important to support that in a way that it would be as true as possible. And it did need some structure and some control, but it's also very narrow. I mean, Twitter is super broad. And yeah. If their mission is to be broad, then there's going to be issues. So in a way, I solved that problem. It's not really a solution, it's just a limitation. And when you focus on something very narrow, you can do that well. And I think that's that was important for me, to do one thing very, very well, instead of doing so many things. Because we taught English through text messaging. We told them about events. We had sort of a Craigslist channel as well. And now we're sort of trying to funnel that information back into the main channel, which is leading by the checkpoint content. But originally, it was all this plethora of stuff that was hard to manage because I was the person creating most of the content. And when I found out how to channel both the user participation and supporting the content in a way that was useful, I decided to create a very strict and rigid framework around that. And so,
yeah, and one successful example that's not Twitter-based, but is the news spread by way of Twitter, is the challenges that Detroit residents were having when they were getting their water cut off, you know, especially those, you know, many of whom were economically disadvantaged, and two black women, Chrissy Tillman, at the time she was a designer with IDEO, and Tiffany Bell, who's a coder. And I think that Tiffany Bell was a participant in the New Me Accelerator program, which was actually created by another person, another black woman. And they created the DetroitWaterProject.org, I think. Yeah, I think it's DetroitWaterProject.org, where any of
still
us
up.
Could
People
go
still
on.
Need help, too.
Yeah, yeah, like any of us could just click on that site and pay somebody's water bill in Detroit. But it spread like wildfire on Twitter. Mm-hmm. Whereas if, you know, had they just created it and then tried to, you know, spread the news the traditional way, it probably would not have received as much
too support. Much activism. The editor says, no, it says call to action. We can't cover that. So I have dozens of more questions, but I'm sure you in the audience have the same questions that you're thinking of too. So let's start asking them. I'm right here in the middle.
Thank you so much. I really enjoyed this conversation. How is justice negotiated with on the mediums themselves? So I think about somebody like Shirley Sherrod, who there was a video that was deliberately manipulated to make it seem as though she was had some sort of bias against white people she worked with in her government job. And then social media then decided it was their mission to enact a justice that said she needs to be shamed, she needs to lose her job. And how you're thinking through these questions of what, particularly shaming, and how that works in these spaces and how justice is enacted on Twitter or on these mediums, because when you raised a point about, say, you can say anything you want on Twitter, no, you can't. Not because Twitter will shut you, the institution of Twitter will shut you down, but maybe the response of the people on Twitter.
Well, let me clarify for everybody. Shirley Sherrod and her husband are older civil rights activists and farm and land and black land advocates. As you know, she was a government worker. At the time, you know, there was a black farmers versus the Department of Agriculture, and the black farmers won that large case. When the Shirley Sherrod issue happened, that came from Andrew Breitbart News, right wing, purposely trying to attack and misrepresent, which is, that's just the kind of devilment, I'll say, that we're used to from those sort of right-wing activists, I'll call them that. And as
I see that as different from the different from another example of shaming that I'll talk about.
Has Justine because, landed yet?
Right, because Shirley Sherrod did not actually say or do what they said she did. So that was a completely manufactured campaign. And it fell by the wayside, but unfortunately, I will say this, I was really disappointed in the NAACP and other civil rights organizations because they were slow to stand up for her. They actually fell for it. And I don't think that Black Twitter had been self-reflective enough at the time. We had not like mastered our Twitter storms. And another part is that because there's somewhat of a generational divide, many people didn't know who Shirley Sherrod was. It was shameful. I consider that to be a very shameful moment in American history because she decided that she didn't even want to go back to work for the United States government, all right? John Ronson was here, I saw on the program, and I want to debate him so bad. Please tell him that. I like him, I like his work, sort of. But he uses, to a major fault, the hashtag has Justine landed yet, and that entire issue around public shaming and whether or not we should shame people, et cetera, et cetera. Long story short, Justine was a PR exec, all right?
Made money.
White woman, PR exec, who was flying to her hometown of South Africa, as if that matters, but they like to point that out these days. So I'm just gonna put it out there. She was from South Africa. And she had about 500 or so followers, which is plenty more people than, you know, than are even in this room. 500 followers is still a lot. I mean, I know that, you know, we're into thousands, but still. That's like a whole school full of people. And she tweeted out, you know, I may mess
it
up
was,
the exact,
yeah,
but it was like,
she
born to Africa,
sad
you know, hope
joke.
I don't get AIDS, you know, ha, ha, ha.
I'm
know,
white,
like
so
that.
I won't.
Yeah, because I'm white. You know, just kidding, I'm white. Like, I won't get it because I'm white. And she tweeted that, and then she got on her plane. And it was actually a white writer who was a media person who took that tweet and sent it out, you know, retweeted it, you know, around Twitter. Now, what actually happened, which is why I want to talk to John Ronson so bad, is that other white people, including white people at her job, said, that is horrific, I don't like it, this is disrespectful, this is misrepresentative of our company, we don't like it, blah, 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 blah. Black Twitter's hashtag was, has Justine landed yet? Because we read some of those tweets and we were laughing, saying, does she know that she's about to be fired? Does she know that there's...
She lost her job while she was in the air. It was so swift because
right.
She was flying from New York to South Africa. It was such a swift reaction from her company that, yeah,
right,
she landed yet because she just got fired.
Right, and her boss actually tweeted it out. So Black Twitter saw that happen. And I mean, I feel like it gets skipped over and Black Twitter is blamed for Justine being fired. We are not responsible for Justine being fired. First of all, Justine is responsible for her being fired. And second of all, her boss, her own boss, decided that is not representative of our company. Now, according to Justine, she was just joking. She didn't mean that. Of course, she's an ACE activist. Of course, she respects Black people, whatever. But what are you doing as a PR exec, even tweeting something like that out? Yes, you should have received repercussions for what you did. And no, it wasn't just a tweet. I mean, there are lives on the line here, and it doesn't matter to me that you only had 500 followers. That's a lot of people. And for you to be a PR exec, that could have been, clearly she was connected to many, many media outlets, right? She had like a power list. This is not just like 500 people who just are sort of random throughout America. So it's a problem. Then someone else found that Justine had tweeted many other problematic things. She had done some fat shaming. She had, you know, done like other, you know, disrespectful to other cultures. Like Justine, I think that she just got her little side hustle comedy show on her Twitter timeline, and she finally got caught. And the problem that I have with John Ronson is that he's like, you know, we just shouldn't shame people. I mean, we're in this shaming culture. And I'm like, wait a minute. If you are an executive, if you are a corporation, if you are an elected official, if you're a police officer, if you are in these positions of power, and you are doing damage to people, and literally, you know, I mean, when you talk about AIDS, we are actually talking about the ways in which ignorance perpetuates more ignorance and causes the loss of life. You must be held accountable. Mm-hmm. And I have a major problem with people who lately they've been pointing to Black Twitter and saying, oh, we're so tired of you all shaming people. And we're saying, we're tired of your racism. We're tired of the system of white supremacy. We're tired of sexism. We're tired of your homophobia. Like, it's not like these are, we have like random, you know, causes that we're just sort of like, you know, attacking people left and right for like no reason. Like, these are, you're doing things that harm people. And the difference is that before Black Twitter, before Latino Twitter, before Indian Twitter, you could get away with it and you could laugh with it amongst your friends and continue your power relationships. And Black Twitter came along and said, we're going to stop it if we can. And thankfully, we've been able to stop some of it.
Yeah, I mean, you can also never tweet. You can also not tweet. That's what I like to tell people. Especially Adele was just saying that she actually sends her tweets through two different people. She writes them herself, but she said that she used to drink too much and get on late and make off-color jokes. So let's take another question.
So in the midst of this conversation, I've been reminded of a quote by Audre Lorde, which is, you can't really dismantle the master's house with the master's tools. And I see social media sort of as a master's tool. So I was curious if you guys had thought about the limitations of social media in the context of actually addressing social justice.
Yeah, and I wonder about that, if you could maybe answer that first, David, because, you know, police surveillance, FBI surveillance on Twitter, on social networks is 100% real. Yes. And I wonder how you combat surveillance with a more closed system, particularly a system that is specifically built to deal with police.
What we do is completely legal, and that was a big thing to find out at the very beginning. When the cops are out there and they're doing their thing, it's public knowledge and they're in a public space, and reporting it either through a Facebook or Twitter should be part of your freedom of speech. And so, as I mentioned before, my goal is just to provide that medium and connect the dots and connect people in the community to be able to be the conduit of that freedom of speech. There are very interesting cases that I've come across where people have reported, or they've called to ask me to report a false police checkpoint because there's been, they know that there's drug deals on that street or people are speeding on that street. And so, it creates a very interesting opportunity because what the community is showing is that they know maybe better than the police where policing should be done. And so there should be a better communication between, or partnership between the community and the police that I am noticing could be, but there isn't. And so that's a huge opportunity for social justice and for just having a, you know, people will call me because they don't trust the police sometimes to report either some criminal activity or a missing person. And so we have this role right now, as it is today, between the police and the community. Some police like it, some police don't. Some police acknowledge that they can't do anything about it. They just see it as another technology that has come around and is doing its thing. Much like Waze. Waze is a similar thing. I think that the police that do like it and acknowledge that we're doing a good thing is police that see us as expanding or amplifying their presence in the community. Because at the end of the day, what a cop might want to do is just have an impact, communicate to the community that he is out there watching. And so when somebody reports that he is there, and a lot of people get that message, then his just presence just got amplified. So there's very interesting opportunities that have come about just by offering the service out, and I think that we haven't really gotten to the social justice part necessarily yet, except for the fact that we're just informing people about the presence, and that's helping already.
Absolutely.
But I think the next step is to maybe forge that bridge between the police departments, whether they're county, city, state, and the community, because the community has more knowledge than they're giving credit for. And that's, I think, what you also find is that it's the community who really could do, could bring out justice and correct people in an authoritative position that have a bigger just access to the media, just just by giving the right tool to the right folks.
Mm-hmm. And I would want to suggest the group We Charge Genocide, which is based here in Chicago, you know, uses on social networks to organize real world action. They've been to the UN, presented a report on torture in the US, and actually, you know, got the UN Committee Against Torture to specifically recognize the torture that the Chicago police has been committing on young Black and Latino people in this city for decades at this point. And it's, I mean, I'm sort of interested in like what tools you would use that are not the master's tools. It's kind of like finding the balance between like you've got to use a bit of the master's tools and then you have to.
Well, I'm not criticizing. I was asking, yeah. As in your experience, what do you think those limitations are, and have you encountered them?
The obvious danger is that we can just be shut down. You know, I mean, that's real, right? We live in America, but I'm sure many of you have read many different stories where the country just said, you know, you all will not be on the internet. You know, mm-hmm. Like we're gonna engage in police repression, we're gonna kill people, et cetera, and we have already shut down the line. So that's what happens when you live in a totalitarian, you know, government and whatnot. So I'm thankful. You know, at least that we have the veneer of freedom of speech. But I remember specifically, and I'm sure this, I remember how other members of Black Twitter were complaining about Twitter itself and saying you censor certain hashtags, you censor certain things, but you don't censor others. And I would not know enough, I know about the complaints, but I don't know enough about the back end to know whether or not that's true or if it was just a certain algorithm.
No, this is the execution of James Foley when ISIS operatives uploaded the execution video of journalist James Foley being murdered. Twitter eliminated that video. They were on it, deleting it, getting it out of there as fast as possible when the video of Walter Scott being murdered in South Carolina by a police officer. He was shot in the back. This guy's been indicted. We don't know when his trial is. That video was able to just tumble down people's timelines, auto-playing, and that's, you know, a very serious question. What is it about this foreign journalist execution versus a citizen state execution happening? Why is one more tolerable to Twitter?
Right, and I do know that ISIS heavily recruits from Twitter. So that's definitely one reason why. But I actually meant that, you know, there were people saying, hey, you know, this hashtag trended and we were fighting against this and you know, we it slowed down. I mean, I've seen a number of different conspiracy theories. I don't dismiss them all. But the limit, quite frankly, is that if you don't own the means of production, then it could be shut down at any time by the owners.
All right, well, it is 5 p.m., so we have to wrap up this conversation here in this room, but I think we're all hanging out a little bit longer up front, and I want to thank everybody for coming and joining in.
That was fast.